This video is sponsored by Skillshare. Go to skl.sh/trashtheory2 to get 2 months free.
And, you know, to be quite honest, he's a very clever dude because we're still sat here that many years now still talking about the Blur and Oasis thing. And you know what annoys me the most about it all? It's Blur and Oasis. Why did their name get put first? It's fucking Oasis and Blur.
In 1995, two of the biggest bands in Britain went head-to-head on one of the biggest chart showdowns of all time. Those bands were Blur and Oasis. The UK public and press were captivated. It marked the end of Britpop as a fringe movement and transformed it into the most important idea in British music since punk. It also signalled the beginning of the end, the inevitable oversaturation of the moment. But before that, who won the Britpop War?
Hello, we're Blur, and I'm Damon, and I'm a singer.
I'm Graham, and I play the guitar.
I've got a big bass guitar, and I'm called Alex.
I'm called Dave, and I play the drums.
Blur formed at Goldsmiths University in London. They were a typical UK indie band of the time, signed to Food Records, and not all that worried about making money. More interested in making interesting music. That all changed in 1993. After a homesick-inducing two-month American tour, Blur hit on an idea, a reaction to the US rock scene of Nirvana and their clones. Blur could kickstart a British scene of bands in love with Britain's own influences. The Beatles, the Kinks, the Who, the more cerebral sides of punk rock, Madness, the Specials, and the Smiths. British bands that celebrated all things British, their cultural identity via music. This, with bands like Suede, Elastica and Pulp, would become known as Britpop. After a commercial misstart with their second album, Modern Life is Rubbish, Blur released Park Life, which went in at number one and remained in the UK charts for the next 90 weeks. It was a selection of songs about British people that sang of 18 to 30 holidays, the shipping forecast, and the internalised existential dread. The album's title track features verses from none more British Quadrophenia star Phil Daniels, which tells the tale of working class existence. The chorus shows exactly where Albarn was aiming these songs. The elusive idea of universally appealing pop music was Blur's intent, but their soon-to-be rivals, Oasis, were creating this without the help of UK cult film royalty. Oasis were formed from the council estates of Manchester in 1991, far removed from the trendiness of London. Central to the band were the Gallagher brothers. Liam was the cocky, self-assured frontman, projecting eternal cool. But Noel was the mastermind of the band's music. He dealt with his bandmates' unrefined skills by simplifying everything to bar chords, root notes, and simple 4-4 rhythms. As John Harris said in The Last Party, it was so devoid of finesse and complexity that it came out sounding pretty much unstoppable. And people loved it. Their first album, Definitely Maybe, entered at number one, before then becoming the fastest-selling debut in UK album history. As opposed to Park Life's character studies, Definitely Maybe was filled with anthems, not about, but for the British everyman. There was nothing especially clever about the instrumentation or the lyrics, but it spoke to people. Despite it being essentially gibberish, when Liam sang about feeling supersonic, 2.1 million Brits knew exactly what that meant. At 95's Brit Awards, a celebration of the UK pop music scene, Blur won an unheard of 4 awards. Best single and best video for Park Life, best album, as well as best British group. This was unprecedented. Previous to this, UK indie bands were cult concerns. They weren't supposed to be producing golden platinum selling albums, earning Brit Awards, or becoming household names. And yet, this is exactly what Blur and Oasis were doing. They became the most important and biggest bands in Britain. Albarn reflected on the two bands' shared lofty positions in the band's best British group speech.
I think this should have been shared with Oasis. Yeah, much love and respect to them.
Little did they know that would be the start of something a whole lot less amiable. Oasis' lead single off their follow-up album was Some Might Say. Albarn describes what happened next. When Oasis got to number one with Some Might Say, I went to their celebration party, you know, just to say well done. And Liam came over and he goes, number fucking one, right in my face. So I thought, okay, we'll see. Both bands had their new albums scheduled for autumn of 95. Blur's in September, Oasis in October. No clash, no issue. Both bands could release their albums unmolested by the release of the other, which could mean number one albums for all. But with the singles, there was a problem. The Oasis team had set Wrong With It to be released on the 14th of August, a week before Blur's Country House. Andy Ross of Blur's label, Food Records, said, "We thought they were mad, but the thing is, a number one record tends to have a better than evens chance of being one the week after, just because it's on Top of the Pops and all the kids hear it." So had Oasis released their single before Blur, they would have had number one. And by that logic, they would have had an extremely good chance of staying there the next week, even if Blur had a good crack at it. We had to move the release date. If they stopped the release, it would look like Blur were running scared, and they would not hear the end of it from the boisterous Oasis lads. The only solution, facing them head on and releasing Country House on the same day as Roll With It.
And I still really don't know who moved their release date to coincide with anybody else's release date. It was probably Damon.
And so, it was on. The battle of Britpop. The fight to find out who was the biggest band in Britain. The singles themselves were not the best representations of the bands, nor their best work. Country House was an almost parody of what they had done in Parklife, complete with oompa horns. The song sketches a caricature of a man having acquired a fortune, becoming exhausted by the city, and then retiring to a rural life of antidepressants and weight watching. Albarn later commented that it was shit. Roll With It, on the other hand, did little more than their previous singles like Rock and Roll Star or Shaker Maker had done before. Q Magazine said of the lyrics, "They scan, they fill a hole, end of story. They say nothing much about anything." Despite the quality of the songs at war, the UK music press were loving it. Steve Sutherland of the NME created a cover inscribed British Heavyweight Championship. It was nationwide tabloid fodder. Albarn even appeared on the 10 o'clock news.
Both bands have really upped the stakes, and someone's going to come out on top and someone's going to come out second, and you know, by the very nature of being in a band, you're always quite competitive.
Of course, this became more than just about the music. It was a proxy battle for North versus South and between the very British class system. Blur were from the South, stereotyped as financially better off and better educated, so Oasis dubbed them art school wankers. Because Albarn sang in a mock Cockney accent, at odds with his class and upbringing, Blur were considered inauthentic. Oasis were from the North. None of the band went to college, and pre-band spent time as construction workers. The press held them as working class heroes.
"I worked on building sites. That fundamentally makes my soul a lot more purer than theirs."
All through, there were comparisons to the 60s. Not just in the influences, such as Oasis' Beatle obsession, or Albarn's love of Kinksian character studies, but in how much of a cultural moment this was. As Mike Smith, Blur's press agent, reflected in 2015, "When I got into the business in the 80s, people claimed you would never have a band like the Beatles again, because everything was so fractured, and you couldn't capture popular culture. In the 90s, you had two bands that did capture it. There were also similarities in the current rivalry to the Beatles and Rolling Stones. But the difference was that the respected labels made a point to never have them compete head on." On the eve of the results, Oasis were deemed to be the favourites to win, bookmaker William Hill giving odds of 6-4 in their favour. In the end, Blur won out, outselling their rivals by 58,000 copies, 274,000 to 216,000. As a reward, the band played Top of the Pops, with Pulp's Jarvis Cocker introducing them.
"I'm going to take in part of the support, not the winning. We don't want a civil war, but tonight, there's no denying, Blur are Top of the Pops."
So and story begins.
In the performance, they bop around victorious, Alex James wearing an Oasis t-shirt for added antagonism. All except guitarist Graham Coxon, seemingly not enjoying the moment at all. Later on that night at the Soho-based celebration party, Coxon, overly drunk on free wine, contemplated jumping from the window. I think Graham just thought, oh my god, this isn't what I wanted when I was listening to the Pixies and Pete Townsend. I didn't want to be sitting in a Ponzi Soho club with an Oompah record at number one. What have I done? Graham was very disillusioned at that point. The repeated saying about the Battle of Britpop is that while Blur won the battle, Oasis won the war. Blur's album The Great Escape came out in September, as planned, and went straight to number one, but never hit the same highs as its predecessor. However, What's the Story Morning Glory by Oasis was unbeatable. With the help of alternative national anthems like Champagne Supernova, Don't Look Back in Anger, and Wonderwall, it became the fourth best-selling album of all time in the UK, and even managed to succeed in America where Blur had repeatedly failed. At the 96 Brit Awards, Oasis won 3 awards, which blocked Blur from winning anything. Just like Blur did before, Liam remembered to shout out their rivals in their speech.
I'd like to thank all the people.
All people, so many people, and they walk your counting house, engineers through their shite life.
Oasis signalled their ascent to the role of biggest British band with 2 sellout dates at Nebworth, the biggest concerts in British history, of which 4% of the British population applied for tickets. After that, the Britpop moment popped. Blur's next album was more indebted to American alt-rock like Beck or Pavement than their former loves of The Kinks or Specials. It also spawned the least Blur-sounding hit ever in the form of Song 2, ironically their first significant hit in the USA. Oasis' next album, Be Here Now, sold 8 million copies, but people were less impressed with what little Oasis had to say, and they moved on to the next thing. It was the end of an era. Blur split in 2003, while Oasis would continue on with mixed results until 2009. But that is not the end of the story. A less obsessed over repeat of this battle of Britpop happened 10 years later in September 2005, when Oasis single The Importance of Being Idle was knocked off the number one position by Albarn's new endeavour, Gorillaz, and their song, Dare. While never on the same scale of media hysteria as 10 years previous, it was still noted on in the press. Gorillaz would help Albarn gain the kind of traction in America that Blur never succeeded in achieving. They became known for their various guest artists, but the most surprising was in 2017. After over 20 years of bad blood, Damon Albarn and Noel Gallagher performed on the same track, We Got the Power. Liam was not happy. He tweeted, "That dick out of Blur and the creepy one out of Oasis need to hang their heads in shame as it's no dancing in the streets." And so, of course, the press talked about it. It's an endless cycle. Such is the way of media-fueled battles. If you just let it go, people will realise those antagonisms, those harsh words in the press, they're not real. They are there to make the story more exciting. When there are sides, when there is debate, when there are fights, you captured a pop cultural moment. Without that, would anyone have even cared? This video is sponsored by Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community for creators with thousands of creative, business, technology, and lifestyle classes, with a huge range of potential skills to learn or refine, from writing classes to how to edit video. Whatever you want to do, there's a course for that. Want to know how to create an educational video like this? Check out Sam from Wendover Productions video on exactly that. Premium membership gives you unlimited access, so you can join the classes and communities that are just right for you and your New Year goals. Whether you want to fuel your curiosity, creativity, or even career, Skillshare is the perfect place to keep you learning and thriving in 2019. Skillshare is also super affordable. An annual subscription is less than $10 a month. The first 500 people to use the on-screen link can get 2 months of Skillshare Premium free. You made it to the end, so you may be wondering, who won the Britpop War? That's easy, it was Radiohead. Thanks for watching. Like, comment, and subscribe. And Patreon is also a thing. Shout out to new patron, Barry Hall. Thank you. See you in 2 weeks.